So, we are trying to continue the third chapter of our course in percepting and acquiring skills in density functional theory. And today we will be dealing with one of the other theorems that forms a background and proves to the rest of the world that one can trust calculations made with density functional theory. So let me overview our everyday administrative activity and then we'll go to science. So the homework that is active now, it is some brief verbal answers regarding these theorems. It should be I would spend maybe 10 minutes to complete it. It shouldn't be difficult. And it is due on Tuesday. Well, maybe I do not remember exactly if I asked you to type in maybe one formula, but it is no calculations. It's theoretical, abstract work. So there will be chance to meet in lab on coming Tuesday, and there we will focus on the situations. We will keep using density functional theory with new software that we were acquiring for the last 2 weeks, VASP software. And there we will focus on the situation when the energies of orbitals with spin up and spin down are not equal to unrestricted situation, when the total number of spins is odd. Spins down are having different energies. And I think I cannot promise because it is not myself who is doing it, but the same day at 4 p.m. there will be a group meeting with computational chemistry, where one of the group members will be volunteering to give an overview of theoretical background for this understood spin. So it is not part of the course, but if you have a lot of free time, you can stop by and listen. I don't know what will be the content. Okay. So in 2 weeks, on Thursday, April 4th, we are going to gather here in the room and share our progress in learning the VASP software. And we will try to make it very democratic so that everyone selects a subject to present. And I recommend to select such subject where you are least proficient so that it gives you some stimulus to study something new. And we are the goal is to help each other. So the subjects will be how to put in some information to make it run, how to extract output, and how to prepare some basic observables like sensitive state spectra, something related with spin. MD doesn't mean medical doctor. Stands for molecular dynamics here. And also there will be probably one super challenging subject. Dispersion, dependence of energy on momentum. So this part is not included in most chemical software, in Gaussian or Turbomol or whatever you can get. So it is specific for periodic systems, and it is not easy to comprehend, to be prepared to see some little challenge on the way. Okay, so this density functional theory is our chapter number 3. Last time we learned first theorem that helps to believe that density functional theory is helpful, and today we will complete the second theorem and then we will go to practical issues. And I'm going to briefly review what we were doing in the lab, just in case SDSU team is interested in it. Well, they're not on the screen, but maybe they will appear. So for DFT, we start with, we need some definitions, which we already have. We need some old theory for electron gas. Mass Fermi gas. Then we do have two theorems, because some part of the community was resisting density functional theory and telling that it is not pure quantum mechanics, and how can we believe that it does predict properties of materials and molecules. And there are proofs that indeed one can believe to some extent to this result. Then there are practical implementations, how to practically encode what is the, how the density functional theory computational codes are working. Practical implementation. Then observable. Here is the little overview of what we were doing in the basement of art and science during our practical session during the lab. So we were trying to focus on how to do some basic steps for processing output of this WASP software. We were focusing on the contents of the file's outcar, which is similar to .log in Gaussian, and wavecar that does contain wave functions, the orbital. And we were trying to focus on two aspects. The density of orbitals, which is related to density of electronic states, and the simplest way to reflect an ability of material to absorb light. Here are some screenshots that we were discussing on the blackboard. After running the code, the WASP code, the software, we can extract set of orbitals, set of molecular orbitals. They are helpful in characterizing the material. If it is a small model, they are relatively sparse, but from model to model, they can be either sparse or dense. Therefore, one has to summarize this data in some simpler way. Therefore, one converts discrete set of orbitals into continuous distribution referred to as density of state. So one has sparse set of states, and then very dense grid points which represent continuous change of energy. Then one is adding an artificial width to each orbital that can be motivated by two reasons. One, scientific, that at finite temperature no energy, no level is has same energy, experiences fluctuations, therefore energy is wiggles. And second motivation is not scientific, it is artistic, that looking on the very tiny peak is difficult. So one needs to add some artificial width to each state, to each orbital, to for better visual representation. By adding the finite width function to each orbital and adding together those contributions, one is building density of states. Oh, I welcome the SDSU team. I'm doing something specifically for you, reviewing what we were doing in the lab.
Oh, okay.
So here is one key feature of the WASP software that is not present in 99% of other pieces of software. The orbitals are represented not in space, but they are saved, they are internally saved as function of the momentum. And the conversion to the conventional space representation is made through Fourier transform. Here are the orbitals, how they are saved in the WASP software, in the wavecar file. And in case someone needs the orbitals, they need to be multiplied. So here they are functions of momentum. They need to be multiplied by exponential and integrated to get the dependence on the position. Okay. So here are very brief overview of practical steps. I'm not going to squeeze 3 hours into 10 minutes. I'm just going to focus on most important things. So after successful run of the software, one is getting so-called outcar file, that which is equivalent to .log file in Gaussian. And if one is scrolling through this file, one can see the list contains, is arranged as a table, contains several columns. One column corresponds to number of orbital, another to energy of Pontryagin orbital with given number, and another one is occupation of this orbital. So 2 means it has 2 electrons, 0 means it has no electron. And the last one with 2 electrons is highest occupied. First is no electrons, is lowest unoccupied. By typing this command, one can extract Fermi energy, which corresponds to Fermi distribution that we were drawing on one of our previous lectures. It is defined as such energy where Fermi distribution provides half occupation. If there is an orbital at this energy, it will be half occupied. If there is no energy, it is just abstract concept. So we use some little homegrown codes to implement the conversion from discrete set of orbitals to continuous density of states. It uses this code, and please look onto protocols of our meeting on the D2L, but as a result of running them and doing some simple step, one should get a picture like this. If you're not getting it, please contact me or anyone in the class. Second part of our meeting on Tuesday in the lab was dealing with reflecting the ability of a material to absorb light. So the approach that we were using is very approximate. It reflects the ability of material to absorb light in the single orbital approximation. And later in the course, we will go up in the reliability and precision and use other methods. In the one that we were practicing last Tuesday, one is using Dipole approximation as a measure of ability of material to absorb light, and it corresponds to matrix element of position operator between orbitals with different indices. So the orbitals itself are orthogonal, but if the matrix element of position operator is not equal to delta function, it gives, it is proportional to an ability of material to absorb light. And in order to characterize the material, we should have this transition dipole matrix element non-zero, and we should have a resonance condition between energies of initial and final state and energy of a photon that hits the system. So those transition matrix elements are extracted, are computed based on the information summarized in the output of the VASP software, and they are included in the file os_strengths, which contains a list, also table, columns with number of initial orbital, final orbital, some other information, and three projections of this transition dipole vector. So since we are considering transitions from each to each orbital, the number of those transitions is squared to the number of orbitals. So if you have n orbitals, the number of transitions will be n squared. So the table, the list, will be a little longer. Then there is a next little practical task to convert this list of discrete transitions into something more visually appealing, with the same background, same motivation, scientifically. No transition has a well-defined energy at room temperature. There are several mechanisms for line broadening, scientifically. Artistically, the single peaks are very difficult to watch at, so one needs to add artificial line width that in very simplified approaches corresponding to thermal quantum. And this can be reflected as a resonance condition between photon energy and finite and initial energy of electron, and the oscillator strength, which is some constant times transition dipole. So this information and this information is summarized in file oscillator strengths and file spectrum. So in order to get these two files, one is running this code first, and it generates this file. Here how it looks like, so I, J, and here are the X, Y, Z. And next step is converting this discrete list into UV visible absorption spectrum, into continuous spectrum. So this is done by this little piece of code. So it does convert file oscillator strengths into file spectrum, which contains many, many lines corresponding to different transition energies, also labeled with their wavelength and the intensity. Omega and intensity of absorption at this transition. So this file can be visualized with either Excel or GNU plot or some other scientific plotting software. And for the model of titanium dioxide periodic polymer, minimalistic nanowire, this this absorption spectrum looks this way. So please try to get a picture like this when you try to practice the steps. And also let me know if you have some problems, and I strongly encourage you to establish connections and talk to other members of the class. Okay, so this was a little overview, and now we are going to actual lecture, the theoretical background. So we are going to look on the second theorem that provides validates density functional theory. And very briefly, oversimplified way, it is formulated here. So charge density minimizes total energy, which means that in case one does know the charge density distribution or ground state of a given model, this information is enough to determine one and only one minimal total energy of the system, and it will be a correct total energy of the system. So this statement was not believed to the part of the community, was not everyone was believing it, and therefore the developers of the theory provided step-by-step proof. And now it is accepted, and one of the developers of the theory got recognition in form of Nobel Prize. Okay, so let me overview our plan to prove this statement, prove the theorem. So we are formulating that knowledge of the density provides the total energy, and it is the minimal total energy. So we should focus on this, and through some manipulation arrive to conclusion that it is correct. So in going from the input to output, from beginning to the end, we will need a couple of auxiliary background features. So we need to formulate where we start from, what is our initial input, what we start to play with. And this description, this proof, will be based on comparing two different charge densities. The one that corresponds to the ground state that is formulated here, and another, some other density which does deviate from this one. Because we want to prove that we can find the minimal energy, we should show that if we take some other density, the energy will be not minimal. And this deviated, corrupted density, you can call it trial. And we can say that it is equal to our ground state density plus some deviation. And at the end, we should see that energy determined by true, correct ground state density is always equal by that energy determined by corrupt, modified density. So if it is so, then we can, from this point on, we can believe that density functional theory is very helpful tool and keep using it for the rest of the life until you find some better, more efficient theory. So here will be the proof, and it is, the actual proof is so short and so simple that I was reading several books, talking to different people. When you are reading the book, you skip through and keep reading, and you didn't notice that it was a proof in a little paragraph. So it is just three little steps described in one sentence. But one should realize it because it is an important step in believing the theory. So it is grounded on two cornerstones. One is the same cornerstone one. It is the same as in our previous lecture. It is the variational theorem. Variational theorem, variational principle in C++ for wave functions. And cornerstone number two is actually the first Quantum theorem that we were proving before. The statement that knowledge of charge density determines any observable in the system, determines external potential, determines wave function, and determines molecular Hamiltonian. That charge density is, so to say, a fingerprint that allows to reconstruct in a backward logical direction most of the properties of the system. Density allows to reconstruct all properties. Rho gives us external potential, gives wave function, gives component. And merging these three things together very quickly arrives to the conclusion that total density of ground state provides minimal energy. Any objections? Any confusions? So here's the same thing, just in a better than handwriting font. And we are going to set up a plan. So this is really simple, really short thing, but I'm intentionally delaying the story so that we do not skip important steps. So we will quickly overview what are the components of density functional, and we will recall what is functional. Then we will review what are the conditions for this proof, where we start from. And then we will look on two densities and find the wave functions for each of them, and then find total energy. Not find, we are not going to compute anything, but assume that we get an energy from the wave function. And by comparing them and using the variational theorem, you know, that change of the total wave function plus psi plus delta psi total Hamiltonian psi plus delta psi is always less than always less than energy of the ground state wave function. It is the construction that we were starting our discussion last lecture, Tuesday. And here are two symbols. This one means smaller, less, and these two symbols are Brian Kett. Do you see any mistakes? Did one. Yes. Or is it correct sign? Is it?
Dr. Yes. Killen?
Yes.
Is this condition or?
No, it is input statement. So it is variational principle that is developed that was developed much earlier than density functional theory. It is a part of standard quantum theory.
Okay.
So by changing the wave function in respect to ground state wave function, one always gets bigger energy. And what we are going to do now is just to translate this statement, this variational principle, from wave function language to the charge density language. So originally, it states that change of wave function increases energy. And today we are going to translate the statement into density language. From density language. So it is basically what is called second quantum theorem. So it is translation of the wave function variational principle onto language of density of electrons. Okay. So we were overviewing the concept of functionals, and we do agree that there are some procedures. We hypothesize that there is a procedure that converts functions of total density, determined in many points, but it is one electron function, into total energy. So example of such procedure was given by Thomas Fermi model. In the strange space without ions, we indeed convert integration over all densities into energy. If we are dealing with realistic space that does contain ions and does contain electron-electron interaction, repulsion, then we need to add two more terms. So there is a term that was already present in Thomas Fermi theory, the kinetic energy functional. If you would stop our summation here, we would get Thomas Fermi theory. But in a realistic universe where we have molecules and materials, we have ions, there is an interaction electron to ion attraction, and there is an electron-electron repulsion. So what is different here from the standard language of quantum theory and Hartree-Fock and everything that we did before Hartree-Fock, that we are not spelling out the word Hamiltonian. We are not spelling out the word operator. So this functional doesn't need to be operator, and it doesn't need the concept of Hamiltonian. So there are some functionals, there is some procedure that connects total density and each of these contributions to the total energy. It looks like very natural, very simple, but it deviates from standard pathway of quantum theory. important examples for this conversion of the density into terms. Terms can be given, for example, by for this term. We know that operator, quantum operator of nucleus electrons, is summation over all electrons and all ions. Then we do d sub I. One also then to get an energy, one can integrate. This potential that does depend only on position of electron, and the total density. So this equation scans through all places in the space, and for each place in the space, it explores the surrounding ions and integrate the attractive term of electron to ion attraction. We just need the density, and we need to integrate over this density with information about those ions is hidden in this is encoded into this potential. There is nothing complicated here, but it is different view, different look on the total energy. But at the same time, in the traditional quantum approach, this energy can be formulated as expectation value. Traditionally, this V and E is a operator. It is a very simple one. It is diagonal, so it has this R minus R, these different arguments on the diagonal. Bless you. And then the expectation value is found as a bra and ket. Of this operator. But these are two alternative approaches. One can find contribution from electron to ion interaction, the total energy, on the language of the wave functions through matrix element, through expectation value concept. And on the other hand, one can find it just through integrating charge density, through the density functional concept. These are two alternative approaches to find the same value. And they are equivalent, just cast in different way. So this functional of density procedure is a replacement of standard approach of expectation value. And we are going to use the fact that these two approaches can be interchanged in converting the variational principle for wave function into variational principle for charge density. Okay, so next part is what are the conditions? Because rigorous formulations of theorems need some conditions. It will not work for everything. So we consider only such densities that are normalized, that always represent the same total number of electrons. go through. It is normalized the total number of electrons in the system. So through integration over all space, one get number of electrons. And we also agree that there is no place in the universe where one has less than zero electron. Number of electrons cannot be negative, which is normal. Okay, then we start branching. We consider the charge density distribution that corresponds to ground state of a system. And then we consider some trial distribution that deviates from this ground state density. Okay. The things will be very quick from now on. So then we recall our first Kohn theorem. So if we know the density, we know the potential, and we know the wave function. Right? In case we do know the wave function, we can establish wave function for our ground density and for our trial density. So trial and ground. Maybe here is the key point. And if it is so, if our density did determine the wave function, the many electron wave function of the of this electronic configuration, of this electronic state, then we can find the total energy on the language of wave function. We have operator of kinetic energy, electron-electron interaction, and electron-nuclear interaction. And we are finding it as a expectation value of trial wave function. But at the same time, we understand and agree that the same total energy for the same system can be expressed in terms of density only. So we have the same energy cast in two ways, as through density and through wave function. So we are doing it for trial density and for ground density. Then we do a second important step. We apply variational principle for wave function. That deviation of wave function from ground state predominantly gives bigger energy. So energy computed in this way will be bigger than energy computed by this way. In this part, we are blindly applying variational principle. But before, we agreed that total energy can be equivalently defined either by density or by wave function. So we know that if on the right side, this upper total energy as wave function trial is bigger than energy computed through wave function for ground density. If it is correct on the right side, then it should be also correct on the left side. So energy computed based on the trial density should be bigger than energy computed of the ground state density. And if it is so, then it is what we stated as our purpose. So there were no logical challenges. It is just tracking the chain of logical connections. So we established the connection between density and wave function, borrowed from the first theorem, and here we applied the variational theorem. And the result, we proved that, well, not we, Kohn and Kohnberg, that any change of the total energy in respect to the ground state density will increase the total energy. Which means that as soon as we do have ground state density, we immediately have the minimum of the total energy. And this nice statement can be solved to outer world. There is a method that finds the minimal energy. I think that's it. There is a little verbalization and analysis, but it is the basic statement that we needed to deliver today. Ground state density provides minimal energy. So we started from considering densities for ground state and a little bit deviated. We used the Kohn theorem and variational principle, and we arrived to this inequality. So now we can, based on this theorem, we can state that ground state density provides minimum of total energy. So why it is so important? Why we spend time on these simple steps? Why it is needed? Why one needs the density functional theory if we had if there are some other theories? It is a minimalistic approach. If someone hires us to find the total energy, which is just a single number, why should we utilize multidimensional electronic wave function, multi-electron wave function? Is there a way to find this goal, total energy, through minimal effort? If there is a proof that we do not need wave function, if we need just something much simpler, and we reach the goal, then we are happy. We are optimizing the whole procedure. It gives a way to get the answer in a much simpler way. The wave function contains too much information. We do not need all of this information. The information provided from charge density is enough for a lot of studies of material. So through these two theorems, we arrive to the conclusion that there is an approved, we do approve that there is, it does exist, a procedure that converts total density into energy. But this procedure itself is not known. And to find this procedure, to determine it, is an additional challenging task for the community of researchers. And through year 1965-64, when the theorems were proved, one is trying to build and rebuild and try different ways to establish a connection between density and total energy. And when you let's look back onto our Gaussian and Gauss-U background. If we are trying to set up Gaussian computation, there is an option to select a functional, right? You see a menu with LDA, PBE, GGA, B3LIP. So those are different successful stories how different scientists were trying to reconstruct in the best possible way the connection between density and energy. So there is a proof that this connection exists, but how to find, how to model this connection is still an open question. No one knows how this connection looks like. And one tries different approaches, different formulas, different procedures to establish this connection. And then through proving it or just simply through applying it to different systems and claiming correspondence to experiment, people say that, okay, our functional is better. And many functionals are abbreviated after last names of their designers. So we can easily, during the rest of the class, build up a functional, collect for last names of everyone in the class, and claim to the community that we designed new functional. Let's try whether it will help to solve any problems. And I have a brave plan. I do not know whether it will be possible, but to make one online lecture and establish inviting one of the developers of the functional to give us a lecture through the Skype, show how those connections from density to the energy are developed in practice. Usually, researchers who do it are spending all of their time. It is a lifelong commitment. We are trying just to utilize, to be users of those methods and formulas. Okay, here's a little summary. We learned the first theorem, the density determines, so to say, everything, potential, wave function, molecular Hamiltonian. And second, that ground state density provides minimal energy. From now on, we do see that there is a background to believe results of density function theory calculations, and now we should look onto practical implementation, onto the way how this connection between density and energy is established, and how the codes implementing this connection are written. This will be a task for our next meeting. With this, let me announce the end of the lecture, and I'm open to answer any questions. If there are no questions, then see you next Tuesday, and the meeting is dismissed.